All right, welcome back, everybody. My name is Ben Schubert. I am a filmmaker based in Vancouver, BC, Canada. And today we're talking about the C200 and how I set it up. So we're going to go through the menus and we're just going to talk a bit about why I chose to do certain things. And maybe you'll benefit from that. Maybe you'll just like to see how someone else does it. I don't know. So basically, when I got this camera, I started playing with things. And these are the settings that I like so far. Things may change in the future, but currently this is what I'm into. This is what I'm using to get the look that I'm getting. So if you've seen some of my other videos and you've seen the C200 videos, this is how I'm doing what I'm doing. If you like it, great. If not, great. Sounds good. Have a good day. All right. Anyway, so let's talk about this, because this could take all day. So I'm going to try and be quick, but also clear, because I think there's a lot of really good information here about stuff. So starting from the beginning, the first thing was iris increment. I think I left it as is at 1/3 stop. I think that's fine for what I do, and I actually don't adjust the iris too much, and half stop might actually be more in line with the way I actually shoot, but sometimes it's nice to have that little fine change. So I just kind of left it, and that's fine. Nothing really great there. Shutter mode, I set to angle. That is so much better than having, you know, just having your shutter speed set, but there are reasons to set it to a specific thing, right? So if you're trying to be in sync with certain lighting, or you're finding that you're having some flicker, you might want to actually change away from shutter angle to shutter speed and hit a 60th of a second so that you actually match up with your shutter speed with the lights. Depending if you're in, you know, North America or an NTSC region, if you're in a PAL region, you want to be shooting at a 50th of a second. But generally, I like to keep my shutter mode on angle, because that way I can just set it to 180 degrees, call it a day. Every time I switch my frame rates, it just changes with it and I don't have to think about it, and it's great. And there's times where I like to change the shutter angle specifically. But again, it's really handy for going through different frame rates. Just makes your life easier. The next one, just down from it. So I like to have my ISO gain set to ISO. That just is what works for me. When I started shooting, everything was on gain. Nothing was set to ISO. I like to think of ISO as like a standardized thing, so that if you're shooting on an ISO from one camera, in theory, it should be similar to another camera. Not necessarily the case, but it's just a good way of, you know, being able to reference other cameras, get closer, as opposed to just using gain. I don't use the extended range. And I actually, this is one that I think is actually important. I set my ISO increment to 1 stop. You can go in and do 1/3 stop, which is how this comes. But I don't like the 1/3 stops, because so the way these cameras are set up, every full stop, the gain increment is actually a current change. So it's actually more electricity going through the sensor, or something like that. Don't quote me on it. But every increment between the full stops is done in a way where it just adds more noise, right? They're adding current elsewhere in the pipeline. It's not just directly through the sensor. So you'll notice that any ISOs that are shot between the full stops are noisier than, say, shooting at 400, 800, 1600, 3200. And really, when I'm changing ISO that much, I might as well just go the full stop. I can always stop down using my aperture. So that's why I do that. I actually think this is one of the more important decisions I've made, and it'll save me a lot of headaches in the future. Light metering standard, shockless white balance, all of this. I don't really use auto white balance, so I don't really see it as applying to me. Face detection on, yes. So for autofocus, I use continuous generally, especially for interviews. Sometimes if my autofocus is annoying me, I'll switch to boosted manual focus, which is kind of a nice addition where it's like you can just do slow racks. And then once you get close to what you're actually supposed to be focused on, then it'll just lock onto it and stay. But honestly, I'm mostly in continuous or I'm in manual focus. Yeah, and then frame position, selectable. Frame size, large. I generally like to have a large area, especially if I'm out following things. It just makes it easier. I find that the autofocus in the C200 as opposed to the EOS R, it's a little clunkier. On the EOS R, you can just tap on the screen and then it'll track whatever. But the tracking on this camera is a lot different. You gotta like use something. So I use the focus guide button at the back right here. So you click in, you get this target, and then it chooses, right? Now, I definitely prefer the EOS R system because you can just tap on things, it'll lock on and follow. That's great. All right, let's see. Face detection on. Right now, I have it to face only, but that's because I was just doing talking heads. But typically, I have it set to face priority so that if there's a face in shot, it'll pick it up. Auto black balance, the ABB. I have this put into my quick menu because it's something you need to use at least once a day. It's really important, keeps your noise levels low. So HDR LUT I have off, but that's because I have everything set to Canon 3. So when you get it, it comes with a preset on, which I turn off because then I can get more control over the actual image. And then I set it to, this is one of the other really important things for the image. And this really only applies when you're shooting in the XFAVC or the MP4. Once you're shooting in RAW, these, I don't think they matter as much. I have my gamma set to Canon Log 3, which there's other options that you can go with. But Canon Log 3, I really like. It's a little more contrasty than Canon Log 2. You don't actually have Canon Log 2 as an option when you're shooting outside of RAW, but there are other options. Canon Log 1 is another one that I would potentially go with, but generally I choose Canon Log 3, mostly because I know I'm going to be grading this after. I don't need it to go straight to Rec 709, and in fact, I prefer that because Rec 709 burns in a certain kind of contrast that I don't love. So color matrix. So this is another really important one. For me, I really like Cinema EOS Original. So the camera comes in neutral, but for me, I find the neutral look makes blues seem more teal, which I don't like, and skin tones, feel a little bit more pale. The Cinema EOS Original definitely adds a lot more red to the red channels, especially in the mid-tones. And I find that the blues are a better representation of blue. Otherwise, it looks really teal. So that's the choice that I go through. I haven't really played around with production camera, nor would I. I don't think I'll ever do video. I don't think I'll like that. But production camera might be interesting. I don't know. But for now, Cinema EOS Original is what I like. It matches really well with my EOS R, which is also set to EOS Original in its Canon log. So that's generally what I go with. Activate other settings is on. I have used them in the past, but I've originally turned up sharpness, but I feel like I've turned it down again. Yeah, it's all down now. I had noise reduction on for a while, but I found that I was getting a lot of ghosting in my image, so that's off again too. This is up for whatever you're doing, whether you're shooting in RAW or you're shooting. So my system frequency is in 59.94. And that's basically because I'm not really shooting a film here. I'm not doing a film print. This is going to video, and it makes playback and actual editing a lot smoother, which is better for my workflow. Workflow is important. I need to do video on workflow. So frame rate, that's up to you. Now audio, I like to have as 4-channel because I often like to have, 2 mic sources, right? So basically using the 2 XLRs and then having a safety track for both. So not just having them both play at the same, but have one channel riding as high as I can without clipping, and the other channel riding 6 dB under it, so that if I get too loud, things get too loud, I have a backup. Not everything is burned. It's a safety channel. You should have it. One of the big reasons I went with this camera over another camera is having two XLRs and four channels for recording. I know, it's weird. It's the little things. But that's really what I wanted. I have my Rec Command on for in this area because I often like to record to a Ninja recorder when I'm shooting in the MP4 XFAVC, and that allows me to do it, and it's great. So this is my audio settings. So I select channel 1 and 2 as input terminals, and so that's basically my XLRs. If I was using the built-in mic, that's the monaural mic option. The mic terminal is this option right here. I don't know if you can really see that, but there's a spot right here, the mic input right here, and that's for putting in 1/8-inch mics, you know, the typical headphone jack. So so that's an option, although I just don't use it. But you never know what you're going to get thrown at you and what you're going to need. So it's nice to have the option. Channel 2, I have set put to input 1. And channel 3, 4 input, same thing. And I have them separated so I can do them separately. Everything here is just set. I don't have limiters on. These are good if you're in a situation where things can get really loud all of a sudden, but I just don't use them all that often. I will just ride the audio as I need, so I just leave that all off. 1K tone, great for when you're working for an audio mixer. My HDMI out is recording channel 1 and 2, and I'm actually recording this audio through my mic, which is the Sennheiser MKH416, and it's going right into the C200. I'm actually just recording the audio and the menus onto the C200, and then my EOS R is just this headshot with just like a mic on it just for scratch audio. So that's how this is set up. Now I have my Zebras at 70 to let me know if skin tone gets too hot, right? So if I'm overexposing the skin, then that'll let me know. Then I also have my Zebra 2 levels at 95, and then that just lets me know if that's clipping. So anything over 95 is definitely burned out. Though really with C-Log 3, anything over 80 is kind of probably clipping, at least to some degree. So this right here, this is important, this OSD output. This is the on-screen display output, and this is something that I think isn't in my quick menu, but I need to put in, because I use it way more than I would have expected. This allows you to run your menus to your through your HDMI or not. And currently, that's how I'm recording these menus, so I am doing that. But sometimes I like to have it on, sometimes I like to have it off. It all depends on what, if I'm recording through my Atomos, then I want them off. If I'm not recording, then I generally want them on so that I can see things clearly. Okay, so this in the camera setting, this is specifically these buttons. So for these, I have these set, and most of these are the same as the way they came from the factory, but there's a couple things that I changed because there's just things that I'm not gonna touch and go through. So shutter, for instance, I never change my shutter. So I have that set up so that when I press that button, it goes to my frame rate, and then I can change that easily. See, display is probably still there. ISO is what I would expect, but shutter is that. So this is just a really good way of remapping all the buttons on your camera to what works with your shooting style. I guess the other one that I changed was this number 11, the one shot autofocus, because I don't really use that all that often. I changed this to slow motion recording, though I don't use that either, so I don't know. Maybe I might change it to something else in the future, but At this point, it's just for slow motion recording. I haven't really shot with the 120. I'm like not that interested in it. It's not why I got this camera. This star is my quick menu, which, yeah, you'll see I've got my frame rate, my main record format. So if I want to go to RAW or through MP4, I can do that pretty easily. Over on 2, I've got my auto black balance, but you know what? So I'm going to register on-screen display output because I use that often. Yep. All right. It's successful. All right, so maybe that was interesting to you. Maybe it wasn't. I don't know. But I sure had fun doing it. So if that video was helpful and you got something out of it, can you just leave something down in the comments? Or if you have any tips for other people as to like how they can use their menus properly, things that I, you know, said by mistake, I'm sure you'll say. But yeah, let me know in the comments what you guys think of the menus, how you set them up. Is there anything that you think is a really great option that other people can benefit from? Write it down there. Otherwise, give it a thumbs up if you like the video, and I'll see you later. All right, see ya.